Hello, everybody. I'm very happy to see all of you today, and I'd like to talk briefly about what we're doing in Singapore on the tech scene, and then we can take your questions through Karen. Dominating tech as well as everything else this year has been COVID-19. It's been a big fight for us in the last 11 months. The situation is now stable in Singapore, but it has taken us a tremendous effort to get here. First, we had to have a two-month circuit breaker in April, where we practically locked down a lot of the economy. And also, we had a major outbreak in our migrant worker dormitories, where several hundred thousand of migrant workers lived. And we had to deal with that in a safe way to keep the migrant workers safe and to keep the rest of the population safe. And our priority was to minimize the casualties, the fatalities, and to make sure that our healthcare system could cope. And after enormous effort, I think we've for now reached that position. And we are in a better state because we now have better defenses with testing, with contact tracing, with safe distancing measures, so that you can progressively and carefully resume normal economic and social activities, including just beginning some overseas travel and looking forward, like everybody else, to confirmation of a safe and effective vaccine, which will be a big part of the solution, but not the whole of it. And meanwhile, we have to stay vigilant and not get tired of all the safeguards and precautions we have to take. Technology has been a crucial part of this journey. Biomedicine, certainly biomedical science, analyzing the genome of the virus, understanding the virus, understanding disease patterns and trends, developing tests and treatments for COVID-19, a lot of which involves IT and bioinformation. But infotech by itself has been crucial. We have needed it in order to track our patients and our cases, their status, their well-being, their locations, large numbers of people, including the hundreds of thousands of migrant workers. We've had to collect and analyze data about COVID-19. Who is getting sick? What are the hotspots or patterns? What inferences can we draw? What trends are developing? What actions are working and not? And what should we do next? And even to ensure compliance with stay-at-home notices. Not such a high-tech requirement you would have thought, but technology comes in very useful to know where they are and to be able to keep track of whom we are up to date with and whom we are not. For contact tracing, for example, we've also used tech in many different ways. The last time we had to do this, when we had SARS, which was 2003, 17 years ago, it was a manual and labor-intensive business. For COVID-19, we have had far bigger numbers to trace, and we've had to identify and quarantine contacts as soon as possible because it's such an infectious disease. And we've developed all kinds of solutions for this. We developed Trace Together, a Bluetooth-based app or device to identify close contacts. And we've also open sourced the code so that others can look at it and develop their own applications, which some countries have done. We've developed Safe Entry, which is for you when you're visiting a shop to register your presence there so that you know you've been there, the shop knows you've been there, and if somebody else is there who's positive, well, we can track who else was there at the same time. We had to develop databases like Vision, which brought together all the different sources of information we have, different databases, information from the telecoms companies, information from interviews, information from contacts of contacts, and put it all together in order to speed up the contact tracing and to be able to issue quarantine notices promptly. Because every hour you are slow means so many more people whom COVID-19 might be able to infect. Our response was not flawless. We discovered many blind spots as we worked it out. Our IT systems in the government have been built over the years. Not all are fully up to date, and they don't all work seamlessly together. For example, not all of them could be updated continuously. Many were updated batch processing, 3-4 times a day, using secure FTP, sometimes using Excel spreadsheets transferred from one system to another. And not all our systems were using up-to-date techniques like APIs or client-server models, much less to be on the cloud where they are scalable. And when cases are multiplying, all these delays and inefficiencies make a difference. So we've had to build new products to overcome these, like Vision, like our apps and our tokens, and we've had to develop them in a hurry. There are more than MVPs, minimum viable products, but they are far from polished versions and still work in progress. But they showed we had some in-house capability and it was making a significant contribution. Most importantly, through building them, we learned again, and our people learned, both the tech side as well as the op side, the importance of OpTech. That means the operations have to be enmeshed with the technology requirements right from the start. And the tech people have to be involved early and have to work closely with the ops people to understand the operating conditions, to understand the requirements, to be able to meet the requirements, and to make sure that the technical side is fully taken into account of, and we go to the limits of what is possible, and we are realistic to know how far we can go. It's an iterative process. You have requirements, you must adapt them and streamline them as we develop new capabilities, bring them up to date, situation changes. But we have to work on a very tight loop in the ops tech. So tech has been central to our COVID-19 response. In fact, this goes beyond COVID-19, and it's a command function in a lot of our government. Because to do many of the government functions, you need to use full use of tech. Never mind whether it's healthcare, whether it's administering your pension system, whether you're administering your public housing, whether you're dealing with taxes. Without tech, you are sunk. So it's a command function, and senior leaders have to understand that tech is central to their role governing Singapore at doing public administration. And all public service leaders need to understand technology. More of them need to appreciate technology. More of them must understand the technology, and we must have enough of them who can provide technical leadership on complex engineering projects while taking into account the social and policy aspects of the requirements. So that the tech part is fully made use of, but at the same time, we understand the non-tech purpose to which this is put. And this is very hard to do. It's a challenge for every public service, but I think compared to other countries, Singapore is fortunate to have an environment that supports science and tech. First of all, we have quite a tech literate population. If you just look at use of technology, smartphone penetration, for example, we have more smartphone accounts in Singapore than there are people. It's like 2-to-1, almost. So we are familiar with tech, and if you have a good product, an app, an interface, it's not hard to get people to use it. Secondly, we have good infrastructure. We have built this up over the years. For example, we have a nationwide broadband network. It's not by fiber to every home. It's not by chance, but it was a conscious political decision that we would do this and build ahead of demand and roll it out as a national network, which all service providers can use and sell services on this backbone. And therefore, we have very high internet connection speeds, it's pervasive. And when we had to lock down the migrant worker dormitories, it was a lifesaver, because this was what enabled us to give everybody SIM cards, broadband access, and they could stay sane, could keep in touch with home, keep in touch with the news, and watch movies, and know what is happening. And we built ahead of time. We did not have a killer app, but we decided this was an act of faith. One day we will need it. And sure enough, we did. Thirdly, we have also been building up IT engineering capabilities in the government, particularly through GovTech. It's a long-term effort. We've been doing this for now maybe 5 years or so. We had rudimentary capabilities at the central government level. Our agencies and departments had their own, but we did not have an outfit which would look after the whole of the government. We outsource, and we eventually decided we cannot outsource everything. We have to build our own, and that's what GovTech has been doing. Finally, other than the government, we have a whole tech ecosystem and digital industry in Singapore. Many major tech companies are now based here, and they're doing engineering work, not just sales and marketing. And companies like Google, Facebook, Amazon, Grab, Stripe, CE, which used to be, I think, Arena, and Lazada. And they are in all kinds of areas: cybersecurity, software engineering, data science, AI, creating a vibrant industry cluster and good jobs for Singaporeans. So the pieces are all gradually coming into place, but the key thing which makes it all work is talent. We need more tech talent to grow the industry and to tackle the urgent problems that we have and that tech can help us to solve. The pipeline of students doing tech in our polytechnics and universities is growing. Students are getting their message. Entry to computer science and IT courses and computer engineering courses has become much more competitive. You practically need straight A's to get in. And the graduates are in demand and paid not badly at all. So the pipeline will grow over the years. Meanwhile, the companies are also bringing in talent from overseas, not just young, fresh people, but also at the mid to senior levels, where especially we need people in Singapore. People experienced in building, in developing, in managing large projects and systems. People who can mentor our young talent, who can build world-class teams and shape the culture in engineering outfits, companies, organizations, and therefore enlarge our talent pool and our capabilities, raise standards, and strengthen the tech ecosystem, and I hope get into a virtuous cycle. Of course, it's not one, when you have large numbers of foreign professionals in industry, there will be social issues which will arise. And Singaporeans, in the same field particularly, will feel a sense of competition, even discomfort. And social frictions can develop, especially if there are large concentrations of the foreign engineers who come from a single source. And when the economy generally is down and people feel worried about their jobs, these anxieties rise up to the surface. It's not unique to Singapore. It happens in every country, in Europe, in America. And yet this is an industry which depends on talent and depends on diversity of talent, not just from one place, however talented that society may be, but people with a diversity of backgrounds and experiences and cultures coming together in order to be able to cross-fertilize and come up with new ideas and breakthrough products. So it's a problem that there are such issues. In Singapore, we acknowledge them candidly and we do our best to address them. It requires both sides to work at it. The non-Singaporeans have to make the effort to fit in, both at work and socially when they are in Singapore. And the Singaporeans, on their part, have to be able to understand that this is how new jobs and more jobs will be created in Singapore, and have to feel assured that they will be fairly treated and will not be discriminated against, and will have a fair chance at the jobs and the opportunities and the promotions. And they've got to see the tech companies as bringing in expertise and experience, building up the industry and capabilities so that our own people can learn from them, upgrade themselves, and eventually build up our own talent pool. And this is how our policies work. This is how we work our work passes in Singapore. We issue employment passes to qualified professionals from abroad, and employment passes are issued more liberally than work passes at lower levels of the workforce, and in fact more liberally than most other jurisdictions. For example, H-1B visas in the US, where there's a quota and every year you have that number, and when applications open, everybody scrambles for it, and within a few hours or days, the quota's taken up and that's it for the year. And we don't operate like that. We maintain standards, but we watch the demand, and we make sure that if there is a strong demand and the economy needs them, and we need these people and their experience and expertise, we're able to bring them in. Now, on top of the employment passes, we have just launched what we call the Tech Pass scheme, spelled tech.pass. And the Tech Pass scheme is aimed at highly accomplished tech talent, the movers and shakers of the tech world, people who usually play different roles at once, founder, investor, employee, consultant, academic, people who can contribute to multiple parts of the ecosystem with their capital, with their networks, with their knowledge. And if you are one of them, you can have a Tech Pass and you come to Singapore and, well, you choose your niche and you fit in and develop your role as you go along. Unlike an employment pass, which is tied to a particular job and a particular employer, and if you have to change jobs or decide to do something else, well, you apply again. So a Tech Pass is personal to holder. It will give you flexibility to move between roles and employers. And we're going to have 500 slots in the first instance. It's valid for 2 years, it can be extended, and the applications open in January. And I think this will be something I hope to make people sit up and take notice, and will help us to attract talent to Singapore. Southeast Asia is a different place from Silicon Valley. In fact, nearly anywhere in the world is a different place from Silicon Valley. But Southeast Asia has a lot of potential, not just in Singapore, where with our tech ecosystem, but around us, there's countries where there are markets, where there's demand, and where there's effervescence, and companies starting up and begin and meeting the needs of a population which has got growing purchasing power and demands. And many Southeast Asians are returning back home to their own countries because they sense the opportunity to make a difference with their skills and experiences. There's excitement and there's also some passion to it. So, but even if you are not Southeast Asian, I hope you will consider Singapore as your next destination. There are many people like you who are already here, who are building great teams, doing fabulous things. And if you are seeking a new challenge, please come take a look at us, and I hope join us in Singapore. Thank you, and please shoot your questions.
Thank you, Prime Minister, for your remarks. I was really struck by your point that technology was central to what we did in the COVID response and for other parts of the government as well. It's a command function and not just an executional afterthought. So we are very, very honored to have you here to share about how technology is a strategic national priority for Singapore. I'm Karen, and I've been based in the Bay Area for 4 years now, engaging global tech talent for Singapore. We are based in SF, London, New York, and Boston right now. So when I first started in the Bay Area 4 years ago, people hardly thought about moving to Singapore for tech at all. But that has actually steadily changed in the past 4 years. As PM shared in his remarks, the tech scene in Singapore and Southeast Asia is becoming more compelling. The region's fundamentals remain strong in the midst of the COVID pandemic. Bain, Temasek, and Google just published a report which showed that there were just 40 million new internet users in Southeast Asia this year. And of the digital users in the region, one third were new this year. So you can see really the growth. Even though there have been geopolitical tensions, we are seeing integration across Asia-Pacific economies, ASEAN countries, Australia, New Zealand, China, Japan, Korea signed the RCEP trade agreement just last week. And most importantly, tech jobs are just growing rapidly. We're at 200K tech roles today in Singapore, 35% higher than 5 years ago. And I just heard that we're adding 30 to 40K more tech jobs in just the next few years alone. But if you talk to any employer, whether it's the government or the tech giants or startups in Singapore, they would say the biggest challenge is just lack of talent, lack of tech talent, especially in software, data, product management. 15% of the roles are very hard to fill. And that's why we're just so happy to be able to engage, for PM to engage these 7,500 registrants for the Tech Forum today in, I think it was 83 different countries, 100 nationalities. We do have a large proportion in Singapore, 60%, and followed by the UK and US, about 25%. And a lot of you are already tech professionals. A lot of you are in these mid to senior roles. And so we're very happy that you also get to network in the virtual lounge since 1st November, where about 3,000 people have been actively chatting about opportunities in Singapore. All right, a brief overview for today. I will start off by asking PM some hot button questions that have been asked of my team over the past 3 years, as well as the many time zone people who couldn't tune in. They actually filled in our pre-event poll. So these hot button questions. And then we'll open up to the floor. I already see many questions coming in. Post your name and location with the questions so that it helps with context as well. And we'll try to answer the questions mainly through the lens of tech. All right, so let's begin, PM. I like to just ask you, on a more personal level, I've noticed that you've been very involved in pushing the technology agenda and the tech talent agenda for the government as well as for the broader Singapore. What makes this such an area of passion for you, PM?
Well, first of all, I did tech at university. I did maths and computer science. It's a very long time ago. It was before the internet. It was at a time when people talked vaguely about something called the ARPANET, which was on the other side of the Atlantic in the US. But it gave me a sense of the challenge and the excitement and the potential of IT. And I have not kept current as an engineer, but I have kept an interest in it over the years, and I've watched how it has transformed beyond recognition in one lifetime, and is continuing to transform very rapidly every year. And it's an enormous advantage for society, which is able to take full advantage of this, to maximize its capabilities and to be competitive in the new world. And in Singapore particularly, I think that it is an area where we have a natural strength if we put our minds to it. Because we are small, we have the infrastructure, we have the education, our people can absorb this, can take to it. And if we can get it into our systems, not just individual apps and programs, but get it fully into our government, into the private sector, into the way we operate and live, then it can be an enduring advantage for Singapore. And that's why I've been pushing it quite hard over these last few years, building up within the government, but also encouraging it nationally with the Smart Nation Initiative.
Yeah, and you launched it in 2014. Since then, you know, there's been more skepticism about smart cities globally. And I recently came across an article in The Economist on how the UK government digital services was stymied by things like bureaucratic resistance and lack of tech talent in the senior levels, as well as the cohesive strategy. So you've mentioned several times you think that, you know, we're not moving fast enough towards your vision that you laid out in 2014. Are we facing similar challenges as the UK?
We have some.
And what else do you think?
Yeah, we have some of the similar challenges. I read the Economist article too. It rang a bell. It's the challenge when you are trying to move a whole society and a whole very big government organization with many legacy systems and many settled ways of doing things, and to transform that and to do it differently. It's very, very challenging. You need the determination, you need the engineering capabilities, and then you need the talent in order to make it work. I think in the case of Singapore, in the civil service, in the public sector, the senior management is fully sold that this is an essential thing to do, that we must make full use of tech, that we have to reinvent. And it's not just making use of tech, but also changing the way we do things so as to be able to capitalize on the new efficiencies and shortcuts and ways of operating which we were totally unable to do before. So I think the will is there, but talent is an issue, and the fact that you have a lot of legacy systems which are settled, which are there, built over many years, very complicated, keeping a live operation going, and you're trying to change the parts and update it without dropping the ball. It's not easy to do at all. And watching it happen, you feel a sense of impatience. Why wasn't this done yesterday? I can understand the intellectual reason why, but I still wish we could go faster.
And I think I really like what you said, PM, about, you know, absorbing the talent, but also is about restructuring so that the talent can do their work. And yes, I think that's what you're talking about. No,
because if you just have the engineers and the government is still operating in a non-digitalized way, the engineers will get frustrated. They will not be able to make full use of what the technology is now capable of unless the government changes its way of working. So we are trying to do this and to re-engineer our processes in order that you can make full use of IT. And the front end, which the user sees, the app or the interface, is just the surface of it. Behind that front end, to make the back end work seamlessly and all the different pieces really truly to be integrated together, rather than just a front end, behind that you've got somebody shuffling Excel spreadsheets. Well, that takes a lot of work, and that's what we are struggling to do and making progress gradually.
Yeah, so it's definitely as much as a human organizational problem as it is
a human problem too. Yeah, and outside the government too. I mean, we have been trying to push digitalization, to do things online, to shop online, to use cashless transactions, and it moves, but not so quickly. With COVID, it has moved faster. And that's the one good thing which has come out of this enormous pandemic. And that is that people have found that they are able to make use of tech, and it's not so hard to learn. And even old people have learned to use tech, either to watch YouTube videos or to communicate with their grandchildren or to order food. And once you've done it, I think you will keep on doing it. I hope, I'm sure, even after COVID is gone. So it's a social process, and that means we have to look to the human part of it. And if we're talking about inclusivity, that especially is another human aspect, because you want to carry everybody along and you don't want some segments of the society to feel, I'm not up to speed and I cut out of this. So we are making a big effort on that too.
And that's a unique role that the government can play as well in making sure that the tech develops inclusively for the society.
Yeah, we pay a lot of attention to that. We've got tech ambassadors to go out and to teach hawkers how to use apps, to teach old folks how to log on to SingPass Mobile, to teach people to be comfortable with, you don't have to code, but to use the thing and not to be afraid of it.
So PM, I want to switch gears a little because we're talking to a global talent community. So I want to just jump into our talent strategy. You know, with the more economies turning inwards, especially the US, for example, in the last few years, and the US-China bifurcation in technology, I've noticed that talent has been thinking harder about where they should settle and build their careers. And you mentioned that Singapore is open. We have the new tech pass, but maybe I want to talk about value proposition. So there's three things generally that talent tell us they look for when they find a job. The first one is breadth of opportunities in the ecosystem. So technical opportunities, the breadth. If I want to change a job, are there those opportunities? The second one is livability. And Singapore, we do quite well on that, but now with the shift towards remote work, we generally see a trend away from high-cost cities. The final one is the culture and of the city as well as the company they work in. And you know, on that count, people have said that Singapore is very different from some of the major tech hubs. For example, socio-political culture, our approach to LGBTQ, for example, yeah. Or our workplace culture, you know, hierarchical still, management culture, still antithetical to engineering culture. So on these three fronts, opportunities, livability, and culture, PM, if there was a talent sitting right here with us in the room, what would you say is Singapore's total package value proposition to them?
Well, I think opportunities, they are growing. If you are looking for hairy, scary challenges, working on the government systems and trying to bring them up to speed and into the next generation, these are amongst the most difficult things you can imagine doing, because it's not just engineering, but it's also organizational, it's also social. If you are looking at the tech side of it, the range is growing because the tech companies are in Singapore and they are doing engineering work, and increasingly so. And really the constraint is a chicken and egg problem. If there's more talent, then they'll be able to do more of this engineering work. But they are looking to do it in Singapore, and they are looking for the talent to come in to do it in Singapore. If you want to be in charge of a hyperscale system, a system like the FANGs have, servers with hundreds of thousands of machines and managing the whole network or global database, well, for now, it's not going to be done headquartered out of Singapore, but one day, as Southeast Asia grows and as the infrastructure in the region develops, I think there will be need, and more of it can be done, or some of it can be done from in our part of the world, which is what has happened in other engineering companies. I mean, if you look at energy companies, for example, quite often they have some of their functions out of Singapore, and these are global functions. And I think tech can, over time, develop in that direction. On culture, work culture, I think, depends on the organization. Existing organizations, it's not so easy to change the culture. They try hard. Sometimes they set up an insurgent outfit within the organization, and then that operates as a kind of skunk works.
GovTech
does that. GovTech does that, and within GovTech they had their own what did they call it? The Hive. And then after the Hive, they've now got Open Government, OGP, I think. Open Government Products. Another skunk works within skunk works. So you can do these things and develop different cultures in a piece of the organization. But you also want to develop new organizations with fresh cultures and be a new generation, as we used to do, as we have done 10 years ago, 20 years ago, and which have become established, and they will transform themselves. But meanwhile, I think new ones will grow. So those sorts of things we will do, and we will have some success. We are already beginning to see some results. On other cultural aspects, Singapore, you have, it used to be people said we were a cultural desert. Now I think if you come to Singapore, it's actually quite a vibrant place to be. Whether you're looking for entertainment, whether you're looking for edification, culture, arts, music, dance, theatre, it's a lively scene. One aspect, of course, is the question which you picked up, which is the LGBTQ question. Here, our social norms are not the same as, say, San Francisco, which is extremely liberal. But even in America, if you go to Chicago, it's not quite like San Francisco. If you go to North Carolina, Durham, I don't think it'll be like San Francisco either. So there's a range. But we have LGBTQ people in Singapore. They live their lives. They are valued members of society. We welcome them. And we greatly appreciate their contributions. And there's no reason why, if you are a member of this community, you should not fit in Singapore. We are in Southeast Asia. It's a multiracial, multireligious society. Issues like homosexuality will be sensitive for a long time to come. Attitudes are not fixed in stone, so social attitudes change. I think if you look at our young people, their attitudes are more liberal than older ones, and in fact probably more liberal than young people's attitudes were 5 or 10 years ago. So these things shift, but we have to give them time to shift, and I think it is unwise to force it, because there will be a pushback and you will end up with polarization and be in a worse place than we are. So I think that I know that we are welcoming people to come, and please come, and the careers are there, and you can ask your friends, but you can live a very satisfied and happy life in Singapore.
Thanks, PM. So I'm going to jump straight into some of the additional questions that people have been posting on the channel now. And, you know, I think there's this cluster of questions around protectionism. So you mentioned that Singapore is open, we have the tech pass, but at the same time, we're not really immune to some of the underlying polarization which brought about this protectionism, such as concerns about opportunities for locals, for the students. You know, what is that trajectory of Singapore's openness for global talent, and how will you address the political pressures that work against Singapore staying open?
I think the key thing is we must be able to show that staying open is beneficial to Singaporeans. It has been so for many years. It's because we welcome in multinationals and they brought in their managements, sometimes a few Americans, sometimes a whole cohort of Japanese management, because the Japanese operate differently. But we welcomed them, and therefore they created many jobs for Singaporeans within the company, and Singaporeans accepted that. And now in a downturn, I think Singaporeans are more anxious about that, and we have to explain and show that by allowing this diversity, by welcoming these people from all over the world who bring with them cultures and experiences and know-how which we do not have, we are able to create jobs for Singaporeans and make Singapore a more vibrant, more prosperous place. And I think we can do that. We have to watch the mix, because if you have a lot of concentration, you have a problem. It is not easy, because you may think that we are in Singapore Chinese and Indians and Malays, and so if you get Chinese and Indians and or people of Malay stock from outside the country and they come into Singapore, then there will not be a problem. But actually it is not so simple, because Singaporean Chinese and Indians and Malays have become Singaporean and have now shared certain values, expectations, made their accommodations, know how to get along with one another. And when you come in from abroad, you may be the same ethnic group, but it's not quite the same culture. And there can be a clashing of gears, and we have to be able to manage that. But it is so everywhere. I mean, if you go to London, you get a pushback. In America, it's a very big issue. It's one of the reasons why Donald Trump has such strong support.
Most definitely. PM, I'm seeing a cluster of questions around cybersecurity coming up, actually.
Yes.
So this is Kevin Lee from Singapore, in Singapore right now. He says, the rapid digitalization of work and life has had a tremendous amount of value and opportunity, but also a dark side in the form of increased cybersecurity risk.
Yes.
So what is Singapore's national cybersecurity strategy to cope with the increased risk? And he's asking particularly for the private sector, because there's a perception that they may not take it as seriously as the government, given the relatively minor consequences.
We take it very seriously in the government. We have watched it for some time, but what caused us to trigger was one occasion when I think Anonymous tried to do a DDoS attack on us on a big scale. I can't remember now, it's about five, six years ago. And we decided that we had to take this very seriously, and we needed to get the private sector to take it very seriously too. So we set up the cybersecurity, CSA, Cybersecurity Agency. We identified critical national IT systems which needed to be properly protected. And these are not just government systems, but even in the private sector. Finance, banking, infrastructure systems to deal with your utilities, for example, healthcare. And we establish standards and channels to track what the entities within those organizations were doing and to set standards and make sure that they met those standards. So banks, for example, where they used to have standards, but sometimes when they outsource the job to service providers, their service providers were not up to scratch. So one bank outsourced the printing of statements to a service provider, and his computer got hacked and those statements got leaked, which is a problem. So we have put standards in place, we're still working at it, but we are taking it very seriously. Within the government, definitely we have done major steps. We've had intrusions from time to time. We've had to tighten up. We had to impose internet separation and deprive many tens of thousands of civil servants of the convenience of accessing the internet from their working desktop, or at least browsing the web on their working desktop or laptop. And it was a nuisance, but it was necessary. Now we found a way to do safe browsing through a virtualized. So we will roll that out for more of the civil servants. But there are technical solutions to go ahead. None of them are permanent and foolproof, but we have to keep on doing it. And we have to educate our people, educate our officers, educate the public, not to be taken in. And a lot of the weakness is just human weakness. You get phished, P-H-I-S-H-E-D. And it happens to all of us. One moment of weakness, you have all the visual cues and social cues, and then you look at the document and you fail to notice that the extension says VBS, Visual Basic Script, and you click on it and you're sunk. And
unfortunately, many of us have been there.
Yes, we've all been there.
Fighting the dark side is much harder, actually, than sometimes. Yes,
and the dark side is a whole dark team. Some of them are very well resourced and very, very determined and knowledgeable. And we have to take it that this is an unending struggle, but it can't stop us from using tech.
Yeah. So, PM, there is another cluster of questions I'm seeing here about growing our own local tech giants. And this has to do with, you know, Singapore's strategy has typically been to bring in MNCs, big companies, but they also tend to outcompete our own startups in terms of talent. Adrian from Singapore is asking, but many in the SF community have also asked this, how can Singapore establish homegrown technology to be giants in overseas markets?
I think we create the conditions, we train the people, we enable companies to start up and to prosper and to compete, and we hope that the talent will develop our own or somebody else coming to Singapore, and one day will either grow a unicorn or strike a home run. And we haven't got unicorns, we have one or two unicorns, but you cannot set out to breed them. You can only make the preconditions, and talented people will sometimes make it happen. And we've got, I mean, short of a FANG-sized company, we've got a fair number of companies which have done quite well and have been bought up along the way. So there is talent, and we just have to keep on doing it. I think my objective is not to develop one big company and declare success. My objective is to have a vibrant industry, to have many opportunities, to have people doing good work in Singapore for our own companies as well as for multinational companies, and that creates not just jobs for Singaporeans, but also a certain buzz which puts us on the map and connects us to other centres where there's buzz and excitement in the world. And then we can offer that quality of life, that those horizons, those possibilities which you would not have if you were out of the loop.
And in this sense, I think Singapore has quite an interesting place in the midst of the geopolitical decoupling between the US and China. So this question is from Joshua and Wei Cheng in SF. They sent this to us on the poll. Geopolitical competition in US and China has spilled over into technological competition in areas like AI, 5G, semiconductors. Both sides seem to be disentangling from the supply chain and technology stack. But Singapore seems to continue to attract people, attract companies, right? Tencent, Alibaba, ByteDance, Google, Amazon, Facebook are all in Singapore. On one level, they're asking, is this good, too good to be true? What risks are there actually for Singapore and ASEAN going forward? On the other level, they're actually asking for some personal advice or thoughts on your end. Are there going to be any risks? Are they going to be forced to choose a side as a technical talent, deciding between China and US?
I think it depends on how the China-US relationship goes. With the next president, with Biden, we will have to see how he manages that relationship. The contradictions between the US and China are deep-seated ones, not unique, not caused by the Trump administration, but during the last 4 years, I think steps have been taken which have ratcheted up the contradictions and which will be not so easy to dial down again. And so, while the tensions exist, we try our best to keep our links to both sides open and to have to do business with both sides, with Alibaba, Tencent, ByteDance on one side and with the FANGs on the other side. And I think for now it is possible. Whether going ahead it is still possible, that depends on how badly or how well the US-China relationships go. And if it is possible to de-escalate, or at least to manage the tensions, then I don't fully trust you, you don't fully trust me, but we do have to get along together and we do have to do business together. Because we both live in the same world and we both face the same global warming and the same humanities, same healthcare COVID-type challenges. And then I think there's a path forward for Singapore and for other countries. But if the tensions continue to escalate, then it's a very serious matter. Henry Kissinger, talking at the Bloomberg New Economy Forum just this morning, says, well, it worries him that it may have an unintended escalation. You're talking about two big powers for the first time, the US confronting another country the same size as it. And you may end up in a confrontation like the First World War. It's a very grave words, but it is true that it's the first time the US is meeting such an opponent. And the Chinese, on their side, know that it is a major challenge to deal with the US relationship. And I hope that sober realization will help both sides to come to a reasonable landing point or a workable relationship.
Thanks, PM. I think the talent as well. You know, I think there is that perception that in the past it's a good thing to work for many different companies with different backgrounds, but now maybe if you walk through one door, other doors will close behind you. And there is that sense at the very micro level among talent. Yes, where should I choose? And where should I live?
Indeed. And it will be a loss for them and it will be a loss for all of us as well, because it means less cross-fertilization, less sharing of ideas, and less progress.
Most definitely. I think even the propagation of innovation across different ecosystems, for example. So I think a lot of people now are asking about different areas of technology. The two that are coming up on our questions are healthcare as well as green and climate tech. So on the healthcare front, we have Elizabeth in Germany, as well as Grace in Netflix, Los Gatos. They're asking about what are we doing to, you know, use the national health records to improve healthcare? You know, it seems that it's not moving fast enough in Singapore on this front.
We are working at it. We haven't got there yet. We were going to have a national medical record system. We were developing it, but we have not implemented it because we decided to pause and review to make sure that the privacy and security issues had been adequately tackled. But we do want to move forward. It is not straightforward. If you talk to the FANGs, for example, they will tell you, why don't you pull all this patient data together and then you can find out so many things about them. And unfortunately, you cannot just do that because it belongs to different people and the patients may or may not consent, and you've got to, you've not just got to work around that, but you've got to grapple with that. But we do want to do it, and I think that we will be able, we have a good chance of doing it in Singapore because we are a small enough system and one level of government, you can pull the different hospitals and institutions together and make it work. But it is going to be a very, very interesting engineering challenge to make it work too.
Yeah, I see so many more questions for you, PM, but I'm going to ask one more, which has been asked by multiple people across the globe, including Troy Yen from Los Angeles, Walter Lee from Singapore. It's about the RCEP that you signed last week.
Yes.
And they're asking, they're saying that's very exciting news. How will it affect the tech scene in Singapore? How will IP protection be enforced? And, you know, what is the opportunity for market access for startups, given that Singapore is actually such a small market?
Well, I think the RCEP is a major step forward for economic cooperation in Asia. It brings together all the 10 ASEAN countries, plus three countries in Northeast Asia, which is China, South Korea, and Japan, as well as Australia and New Zealand. So 15 countries altogether. And it enables these countries to reduce their trade barriers, reduce their tariffs, to improve the rules on investments, improve the rules on services, and for companies set up in one place to do business more freely in the other places. You have to look at the detailed rules to figure out exactly what intellectual property protections you have and what rules you have, what the protections for investments will be. But basically, it's a significant improvement on what already pertains. In the case of Singapore, we used to have agreements with each one of them. We already have agreements with all of each one of these other countries, but what we did not have was a system which covered all of them so that you could accumulate the activities you do in all of the different countries and therefore on that basis get the benefits of the agreement. And that's a plus not just for the IT companies but also for manufacturing and for services and also for other aspects of the whole range of trade as well. So I think if you are looking for a place to go in Asia to set up and hope to do business in more than one country in Asia, Singapore is not a bad place to be because we are connected to everybody else. You can travel there and you can link there. Certainly, you can ping them very quickly because the internet connections are good. And you can also actually connect because our relationships with them are amicable and they welcome Singaporeans to go and work and do business there. Whether you're talking about Australia or Japan or China or Malaysia or Indonesia, you can do it out of Singapore. And all people from all these places can come to Singapore and set up a team and be comfortable here, which is not so easy to do in a less cosmopolitan, more homogenous society.
Most definitely, and with that, I also make a pitch for the Singapore Global Network, which I'm part of. And what we do is we uncover all the alumni of Singapore who've ever lived and worked here. And you know, if you want to expand to different countries, we do want to make that pathway, that personal connection of people who find Singapore dear to them. And you know, that just complements how we integrate and expand beyond our small market size. So PM, we just have 3 minutes left. I want you to want to invite you to make some closing remarks. What would you like to tell our global talent community that's tuning in today and will watch your live stream later?
Thank you for spending time with us, for listening to us. We have a story to tell in Singapore, but we have work to do in Singapore. We are trying to build a society which is different, where opportunities abound, where we make full use of tech, and yet the human spirit will flourish. And that requires the energies of Singaporeans, the talents of Singaporeans, but also we welcome talent from around the world to come and join us and help us to build this society and help us to make this a vibrant red dot, one which will be able to do business with and be friends with many other cities, many other countries in the world, and make a contribution to humanity in a modest way. And I hope that you will take me seriously, come and take a look at what we are doing, think about it, give it a try, and I think you will conclude that what we are doing is worth doing, and I hope that you will also decide, yes, I think I would like to be part of this. So, welcome to Singapore.
Thank you so much, PM. It's truly an honor for us to have you at this year's Singapore Tech Forum, addressing our global audience of tech talent. And personally, I feel that we are very lucky to have a champion in you behind the tech sector and the development of tech talent in Singapore. That's something that, you know, we don't take for granted at all. Thank you so much, audience, for your questions and insights. Even though we were not able to get to them all, I will share them with the other moderators in the next 4 days of the conference. And I hope you tune in so that some of these can get answered. So over to you, MCs, and thank you again, PM.
Thank you.